السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all every form of goodness, and may Allah bless every one of us and our offspring, those to come up to the end. Ameen. My dearest mothers and sisters in Islam, I was told that over and above the learners or the students of Rawda, there will be in attendance our sisters who are difficult of hearing. So it is an honor for me to be here this evening, and I'd like to spend a few moments speaking about the tears of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from a certain perspective. But before I commence, I request that we refrain or abstain from talking, inshallah. We all know the surah that I read just now, Surah Al-Duha. وَالْضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. I think many of us read it so often in prayer, and many of us would actually automatically read it sometimes without even concentrating on the meaning. Perhaps we don't even know what it means. So if we were to go back into history and go back and look at the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would find something very, very interesting. We would find that there was a time when revelation commenced, when Jibreel alayhi salam had actually come with revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the messenger, peace be upon him. And the verses were revealed, iqara, meaning read. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, ma ana biqari'in, I am not a reader, I can't read. And so whatever happened on that day happened. It's not part of what I want to say. But after some time, revelation had stopped, it had paused. And when it paused, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was worried. He was concerned. For a moment he thought, perhaps Allah is upset with me. For a moment he thought, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has left me, forsaken me. Perhaps he has abandoned me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after a pause in revelation, decided to reveal this surah, this chapter, or this portion of verses known as Surah Al-Duha. Now, take a look, and I'd like to dedicate this to those sisters of mine who are seated here this evening, who perhaps are challenged in the sense that they cannot hear, or they cannot hear properly. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whom we all know was the best of creation, the most noble of all prophets, the most loved unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he was born, his father had already passed away prior to his birth. So he was born an orphan. Why would the Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let the one whom he loves the most be an orphan? If Allah loves someone the most, according to our brains and according to our capacity and the way we think, if Allah loves someone so much, that person should at least have parents,
That person should at least have a family unit that is solid. That person should at least have a lot of goodness. And I'm sure in the case of a lot of the children and even some of the adults out there, they might be thinking that if Allah loves you, it means you're going to be a rich person, you're going to be a healthy person, you're going to be a person who has absolutely everything, and that means Allah is happy with you. That means Allah loves you. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that my love for you is not connected to all of that. My love for you is far beyond all of these material things of the world. If the one I loved the most was born as an orphan, later on at a certain age he lost his mother, so he had no parents at all. Who looked after him at that stage? His uncle. His uncle Abu Talib. Looked after his uncle Abdul Muttalib, Abu Talib. In fact, his grandfather took care of him. His grandfather took care of him, and he also passed away. Imagine, at a certain age, even the grandfather passed away. So anyone who started taking care of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they passed on. The mother passed away, then the grandfather passed away. So then the uncle assumed responsibility of this particular child who is most loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what happened is, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam grew up this orphan child, but he was the most successful. He was the most successful, the most beloved unto Allah. And this is why I always say, those who are struggling in any way, remember the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, struggled in a bigger way. If you think you are challenged, if you think you have a difficulty, if you think you cannot hear, so Allah does not love you, you should know that that is wrong. It is not a sign of the anger of Allah. In fact, it is a sign of the love of Allah. When He tests you and He challenges you in so many different ways, when He places in your life hardship and difficulty, it is in order for His love to be manifest or to be made clear within those particular tests that you have been allowed to go through or made to go through. So my beloved mothers and sisters, remember Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam went through much more difficulty than any one of us can ever go through in our own lives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter tested him such that from a very early age, yes, he had a good reputation. He was known as As-Sadiq Al-Amin. He was known as one who was truthful, one who was trustworthy. But later on, when he was given revelation, they said he is a liar. They said he is a cheat. They started accusing him. They started harming him. They started saying so much against him. All that is a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If no one speaks bad about you, it means you don't have anything that they envy you about. If no one backbites about you, it means there is nothing about you to talk about. There is nothing that you have. But the more they speak behind your back, the bigger the gift that Allah has bestowed upon you is. So you've just got to smile and carry on. You've just got to thank Allah and continue. It must humble you and bring you down to the ground. It must make you get closer to Allah. When you cannot see, for example, the hadith says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that whomsoever I have taken away their two eyes in this world, if they have borne the patience required for that, I will give them paradise in return. This is a great gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He means if you bear patience upon the test that Allah has placed in your life, then Allah will give you paradise as a result, or in return for that particular sabr and patience that you endured. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Jannatul Firdaus. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, at a certain stage when revelation did not come, he was concerned. Many of us In our lives, when things happen that are difficult, we ask ourselves, is Allah upset with me? Maybe Allah has abandoned me. Maybe Allah has forgotten about me. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. These are bad thoughts, but they cross the mind sometimes of the people whose level of belief or iman is weak. So they start thinking to themselves, is Allah upset with me? Why am I sick? Why am I ill? Why do I have this constant sickness? Or why did I lose a loved one? Why did this happen to me? And why did that happen to me? How come I suffered a loss? Why is it I'm looking for a job and I cannot find the job? Why is it that I've got a job but there is no barakah or blessing in my money? I'm not able to save any money. Why and why and why and why? Those questions happen to pop into our heads so often without us realizing that the types of challenges that those whom Allah declared His love for went through were far more than the type of challenges, were far more severe than the type of challenges that we are going through. So don't let yourself into the questions, why did Allah do this to me? Rather, go into the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and whatever difficulty you have, while reading through his biography, you will be able to achieve and derive a lot of comfort and a lot of solace. You will be able to feel so good because you will realize what I am going through is nothing. If anyone has lost a loved one, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost all his children during his lifetime, besides one, and her name was Fatima. Fatima binti Muhammadin radiyallahu anha, she lived a little bit longer, a few months longer than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if you take a look at his children, the boys, all of them passed away either in infancy or in childhood. None of them became adults. And the girls, all of them passed away as adults during the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, besides one of them, and that was Fatima radiallahu anha. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has also lost loved ones. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also had people who tried to fight him, people who tried to attack him, people who prepared armies to actually harm not only him but the Muslims, to usurp their wealth, etc. He has been through so many challenges, but he did not lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So going back to this beautiful surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, after taking an oath, he takes an oath, he says, وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. Two oaths. Allah speaks about the daybreak. Allah speaks about that early part of the morning where the light comes out. In the early hours of the morning when the light appears, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing an oath by that particular light. One might ask, why? Well, I want to tell you that there are many reasons. Perhaps some we may know, some we may not know. But some of the benefit is, after darkness there has to be light. After darkness there has to be light. After the difficulty that you are going through, there has to be ease. After the hardship that you are facing, there has to be ease. There has to be a day when that hardship and suffering goes. There has to be a day when you smile once again. Allah takes an oath by saying, I swear by the daybreak. I swear by the daybreak. And then Allah says, and I swear by the night. Now at night, you know, it becomes darker as the hours progress. And the darkness comes with a silence of a different nature. When there is a sound during the day, that sound is not as loud as it sounds when it happens at night. We know that. So this is why Allah says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. That sajah, part of the night, what it's referring to is two things. One is The silence of the darkness. That's the second thing. The silence and the darkness. So that silence and the darkness, or in the darkness of that particular night, Allah is swearing by that night, taking an oath. And then Allah says, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. My mothers, my sisters, before I tell you the meaning of it, this is my favorite surah. This is my favorite surah because in it Allah is reassuring me, and Allah is reassuring you, and Allah is reassuring every one of us who goes through difficulty and hardship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Allah has not forsaken you. He's not forgotten about you. He hasn't left you. He has not abandoned you. And He's not upset with you either. Your Maker has not abandoned you. And your Maker has not forgotten about you. Your Maker is not upset with you either. He's not. Now, when I go through difficulties and hardship, like I said a little bit earlier, many times Shaytan, the devil, comes to us and he makes us think that, you know what? Perhaps my Maker is angry with me. Well, to be honest, it's a good opportunity to seek the forgiveness of the Almighty, because that would help us definitely, whether you know you've committed sin or not. So when we say Astaghfirullah, it actually means, forgive me, O my Rabb, O my Creator, forgive me. That is a very powerful statement. That statement will help you in a million and one ways, in so many ways. But when Allah tells you, I've not forsaken you, I'm not upset with you, I haven't abandoned you, it's not like I've forgotten about you. I know about you. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Then Allah says, وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. These verses were revealed to Muhammad, peace be upon him, at that stage when, just after a pause in revelation, he began to ask questions, and Allah says, no. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, no, we have not abandoned you. And at the same time, we want you to know that the future will be better than the past. The future will be better than the past. The akhirah, the hereafter, will be better than what passed. So it has a double meaning. The first meaning is, your hereafter will definitely be far better than this life. The next life, there will be no difficulty in it. You faced all your difficulty in this life. The next life, there will be no hardship, because you were bearing sabr and patience in this life. So the next one will be better than this one in terms of the lives. The hereafter is better than this world, the dunya. We call it the dunya. So the hereafter, or what we call the akhirah, will be better than the dunya, this life, the life of this world. That's one of the meanings. And another meaning is, in your own life, when you get closer to your Maker, then you need to know that your future will be better than your past. The struggles you faced in the past, inshallah, because of your sabr and because of your hope in the mercy of Allah, the days to come will be much, much better. So this is Allah telling us, walal akhiratu khayrun laka min al-ula. Then Allah gives us a beautiful verse, such a beautiful verse. He says, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And indeed, your Rabb, meaning your Maker, your Lord, will give you so much until you will become happy. Sometimes if a person looks at you and says, what do you want? And you says, I want £1,000. And they say, okay, here's £1,000. What else do you want? I want another £1,000. Here's another £1,000. What else do you want? I want another £1,000. I want £1,000,000. You get £1,000,000. I want £1,000,000,000 and you get £1,000,000,000. And you get so much that you are now so excited. Oh, that's only materialistic. That's only got to do with the pound. That's only got to do with money. So if that makes you happy, Allah says, when we give you, we will give you whatever you want until you become absolutely happy, until you are totally satisfied. Now, if you stop for a moment, do you know, in this worldly life, Allah teaches us that man will never be fully satisfied. Man will never be fully happy. Mind you, we're talking to women, so I'd rather say woman as well. When I say man here, I'm referring to human beings. I'm not referring to the male, okay? So Allah says, or we are told through the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you know, man is not happy. He will not be totally excited and happy. There will always be something missing. And the reason for that is because the hereafter is valuable. Allah says, there you will get whatever you want. If we were to give you whatever you wanted in this life, what is the point of offering you the same in the hereafter? What is the value of paradise if this particular life has in it everything? So what is the value of the hereafter? Nothing. Zero. You can say, oh Allah, I already had in the world everything. I don't need heaven anymore. May Allah forgive us. Astaghfirullah. That's a bad statement. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has taught us that, you know, in this world, no matter what you have, you will never be fully quenched. Let me give you an example. If I ask you today, what do you want? I mean, a lot of you might say, I want the latest of this and the latest of that. Okay, fine. So you've got the latest house, the latest kitchen in that house, the latest car, the latest phone, the latest clothing, the latest perfumes, the latest makeup, the latest of everything. And guess what? You know why you won't be happy? Because as soon as you get it, there will be one later than the one you have. That's what it is. So I have something, but as soon as I got it, being my dream, there is something someone else now has that is better than what I have. So I'm not happy anymore. Why? Because that's how the world works. No matter what you have, you know, I recall many years ago, those of you who are a little bit older, you might know, and even those who are young, a few years back, you have a dream car of people. They'll tell you, you know what? Oh, when I go to paradise, I'm going to ask Allah for this Mercedes Benz, right? So what was the Mercedes Benz? Well, in 1960, it was such a vehicle that sometimes if you were to see it waiting for you in heaven, you would be embarrassed because it will be the worst thing that anyone's ever had in heaven. I hope you understand what I'm saying. So when we say that if I don't get this now in this world, I want it in heaven, be careful. If it is a materialistic item, in your own life, you won't want the same thing a few years down the line. If you say that there is an iPhone 8 that has come out, right? You say, okay, I cannot afford the iPhone 8. But when I go to Jannah, to heaven, to paradise, I'll ask Allah for the iPhone 8. I promise you, by the time you die, there will be an iPhone 80. An iPhone 80. That's what there will be. So you in heaven, you might just get your little iPhone 8 and everybody will be laughing at you. Astaghfirullah, I'm just saying it because obviously it's not going to happen. But I'm giving a point to say, when we wish for things, we'd rather express ourselves in a different way to say, oh Allah, you make us happy. That's why Allah says, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Your Rabb, your Maker will give you so much until you will be happy. So we will make sure you will be happy on that day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness. So I hope you've understood this point where we say that materialism has no ending to it. No matter what you have today, by tomorrow morning, it is no longer the latest. So now your heart is empty once again. You know, you can have the latest motor vehicle, 2017. That's coming up in the next few days, okay? So you have the model 2017 of the car. Guess what? In a short time, there's going to be a car, the same thing, but model 2018. What will happen? Your heart will sink once again. That is the nature of this world. It is the nature of the world. You can marry the most good-looking guy. Guess what? As you grow a little bit older, he also develops gray hair. He will also have to now hunch a little bit. He might also start walking with a walking stick if you're lucky. And he will also become older. Well, that was your pick. That was your pick. So alhamdulillah, when you pick, pick for the right reasons. Don't pick and don't choose for the wrong reasons. Because remember, character and conduct improves with time in most cases. But when it comes to looks, in every single case, there comes a certain age whereby you start looking a little bit older, and they call it aging. I'm now aging, and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, we will definitely give you. The future will be better than the present. And the future will be better than the past. And we will definitely give you so much until you are happy.
وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى.
Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the reminder is for us all, about the favors of Allah upon you. Allah says,
أَلَمْ يَجِدِكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى.
Did we not find you? Did we not find you an orphan? Meaning, were you not an orphan at one stage? So we granted you the shelter. We gave you the comfort. We gave you the place of living, etc. Did we not take care of you? Did we not nurture you, look after you? But you were an orphan.
You know, sometimes people worry to say, if I were to die, what's going to happen to my children? What's going to happen to my this and my that and my wife or whoever else? To be honest with you, there are many who have already died, leaving behind children who were more vulnerable than yours. And guess what? They were taken care of. By whom? Different people. They left behind wives or husbands who were more good looking than yours. And guess what? They were taken care of. By whom? The will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Life continues and it will continue. We pray for the best. What I am trying to show you is, it is not a sign of the anger of Allah when He has taken something away from you. I want to repeat that. It is not a sign of the anger of Allah when He has taken something away from you. It could be a sign of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't misinterpret it. It could be a sign of the love of Allah. Because when we don't have what we want, we tend to pray a little bit more dedicatedly. We tend to become softer in our hearts. Sometimes a person is sick and ill, or they've suffered a loss, financial loss, part of life. What does that do to them? It makes them pray. It makes them turn to Allah. It makes them get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It makes them cry tears for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we're talking of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Here we are. He shed tears. Yes, he did, on many occasions. And we too, when we shed tears for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He loves us because He knows we are turning to Him. So therefore, sometimes He puts what we know as difficulty into our own lives. He puts these difficulties into our lives in order for us to get closer to Him. So He says, it's because I love you that I tapped you on your shoulders with a bit of sickness and a little bit of hardship. It's amazing. It is something unique. And that is the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, didn't we find you an orphan and nurture you, take care of you? We took care of you. I want to give good news to everyone. Weren't we a long time back in a difficult situation and Allah looked after us? Where are you from? Ask yourself, where am I from? Where did I come from? Where did my parents come from? When I was young, how was life? How were things and how are they now? Allah says, hang on, there are so many things we gave you, you're taking them for granted. Don't take them for granted. Remember, you might be going through difficulty now. The future is going to be better, number one. Number two is, remember, you might be going through difficulty now, but you were going through much more difficulty a long, long time ago. You adjusted to that. Why don't you learn to adjust to what you are going through now? It's a powerful point. If you are prepared to think about what I'm saying, it will help you. Where were you? Take a look at those who cannot hear, those who cannot see, those who are perhaps impaired in one way or another. Should I say challenged in one way or another? Technology was not where it is today. There was a time when communication was extremely difficult.
But what happened to them? Alhamdulillah, today you have advanced technology. You have so many different ways of communicating. It is something absolutely unique. Thank Allah that you are in a better position today than you were a long time ago, even though you are facing hardship today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us all. So, my beloved mothers, my beloved sisters, here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding us about the favors that He has bestowed upon us by asking a question to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the lesson is more for every one of us. Weren't you an orphan? And we are the ones who nurtured you. We took care of you. We looked after you. So where you are today is a far better place and position than where you were a long time back. Then there is another verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. Subhanallah, a lesson for us. Where were we in terms of Islam? Where were we in terms of the guidance that Allah has given us? Allah says, weren't you a long time back not on the same path here that you are on right now? We guided you to this path. We guided you to the straight path. Can't you see that? You know, it reminds me today of technology. And how there was a time when people used to complain that we don't have enough scholars in our societies and communities, and we don't have enough people and we can't learn. Wallahi, technology is such today that as I complete this talk of mine, inshallah, if Allah wills, I will press 2 or 3 buttons and this talk from my phone will be uploaded to the rest of the world in no time. Tens of thousands of people will have benefited from this particular talk. I'm just giving you an example. Isn't that a gift of Allah? You want to hear someone, you can hear them. Not just me, but there are so many thousands of people. You want to hear them, you want to know what's going on. You can actually see and follow. You want to follow what exactly is happening in the city of Aleppo. May Allah help them all, because it is something very heavy upon us at the moment. And we are struggling to sleep because of what's going on there. And we are following it so closely. How are we able to follow it so closely? It's technology. Isn't that a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We are guided to something we did not have in the past. Subhanallah. Today I'm standing in front of you by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trying to deliver a beautiful message. And we're using technology so that you can hear my voice, so that you can see what I'm saying. You can actually look into it and understand what's happening. It's the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling this to us in a beautiful way. Yes, I know the verses were revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but my mothers, my sisters, my daughters, in essence, the lesson is more for us than anyone else. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرُ. Because of what we've just told you now, be careful how you treat those who are orphans. Be careful. Be careful how you treat those who are less privileged. Be careful how you treat those who are challenged. Be careful how you treat people who do not have what you have. Treat them with goodness. Do not rebuke them. Do not abuse them. Do not cheat them just because they are vulnerable, just because perhaps they are not as gifted as you are in something or another. Be very careful how you treat them. Watch your treatment of the orphans, the widows, and so many others. Obviously, I'm going deeper than what the verse means, because what is included in this is our treatment of everyone, Muslim or non-Muslim, no matter who they are. Watch out how you treat them. Treat them fairly. Reach out to them. Help them. Give them, be kind to them. Show them kindness through your character and conduct to begin with, and then everything else. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us quite clearly regarding the orphan. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرُ. And as for the one who is asking. As for the beggar, you know, the beggar who comes to ask. Now, it is obviously not something good to go around asking, but it is better than stealing. It is better than cheating someone or deceiving them. It is better than committing a grave sin. So to ask or to beg is something that is only a last resort. So when the people have come to you to beg, you should understand it's a last resort. Allah has, for some reason, tested them, and at the same time, the test is for you. When a beggar asks you something, you must tell yourself, this is a test for me. Either you give them or you don't give them. But don't rebuke them. Don't say a bad word to them. Don't lie to them. Sometimes we pull up at the traffic light, and there is a beggar. This happens to us in Africa and in other countries as well. I'm not too sure about here, but perhaps it might be happening in some areas. So someone comes up to the window and they put their hand out. So some people decide to ignore them. Some people decide to give them. But the worst are those who decide to pull the window down and swear them. Don't you have hands? What the hell are you doing here? Astaghfirullah. Who told you to talk that way? Allah says, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. As for the one who's begging, don't rebuke him. If you don't want to give him, it's okay. But speak to him with respect. And don't lie to him by saying tomorrow. You know, a lot of the people look out and they say, I'll give you tomorrow. But you're not going to pass the road tomorrow. You don't even know where it was. So don't lie. You'd rather say next time. Use the word next time. And that is, if you do have an intention to give them, say next time I will give you. No problem. But rather than saying tomorrow, they might expect you tomorrow. They might be looking forward to it. And if you want to give them something, give it to them. Give a good word. Say, perhaps you might not have something to give them, but say at least, may Allah bless you. May the Almighty bless you. Have a good day. Have a lovely day. I pray that you get more today. I pray that it's a good day. Something good. Allah is warning us to say, you know what? If Allah wanted, He could have reversed the tables. You could have been the one begging, and the person rebuking could have been the other person. If Allah wants, He can turn those tables at any time. So don't be mistaken. And this is why, right at the end, Allah says, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And as for the favors of Allah, as for the favors of Allah, speak about them, especially when you are in times of difficulty. What does this mean? Some people think that this verse means we must brag about what Allah gave us. Hey, you know, Allah gave me 10 million, He gave you nothing. No, 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 no. Allah gave me this, He did not give you that. That's not what is meant by this verse. What is meant by this verse, the whole surah is speaking about hardship, difficulty. The surah is speaking about how the future will be better than the past and the present. So Allah is saying, when you are going through difficult times, the best thing you could do, talk about the favors of Allah at that time. Say for example, a person's leg is amputated. May Allah grant us all goodness and good health. If a leg is amputated, do you know what? They might come up and say, oh, my leg is amputated, I can't walk, now I don't know what to do, I can't sleep, I'm depressed. Allah says, no point in getting depressed. Your leg is amputated, speak about your eyes, speak about your tongue, speak about your brain, speak about your ears, speak about your hands, speak about the favors of Allah, speak about your family, speak about everything else Allah has given you. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. Speak about the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you while you're in the condition of difficulty and hardship, so that it will help you appreciate what Allah has given you. When Allah takes away one thing, two things, three things from us, we become depressed because of three things that are gone. We don't realize there are a million things that Allah gave us that we don't even look at. We don't even consider them. So Allah is saying, be careful, be careful. My beloved sisters, my mothers, my daughters, that was the end of this surah, Surah Al-Duha. Like I said, my favorite surah, and it is. The entire Quran is favorite. Every verse is beautiful. But this surah has in it comfort. So much comfort where Allah tells you, you know what? I haven't left you. I'm not upset with you. Yes, I know you're going through hardship. I want you to think about the goodness. I want you to talk about the goodness you have, even though you're in a difficult situation. Look at the other things that I have given you. And inshallah, you will be able to help yourself through this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Before I leave, I want to tell you, please read the surah in the language that you understand. So you will read the Arabic, and then you will pick up the English, and you will go through the surah, and the next surah as well is powerful. So you go through the surah and read it every day if you can, and understand it, and it will help you. These words of Allah will help you through your difficulty, through your hardship, through everything that you are going through in terms of negativity, because it's so positive and it will really make you feel uplifted. May Allah bless you all. I thank you for your attentiveness, and I really appreciate the fact that you have asked me to come and address you in this beautiful gathering. Please pray for me too. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Mm-hmm.